Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Crossing Boundaries, Four Writers on Fictionalizing Southeast Asia, the second night of the second Singapore Literature Festival in New York City. Started in 2014, the biennial festival brings together Singaporean and American authors for in-depth conversations about literature and society. We are an independent, volunteer-run festival funded by Singaporeans and American well-wishers and supported by institutional partners in New York. We are proud and honored to partner with Asia Society to bring you tonight's program. We want to thank Bun Hui and Rachel Cooper for co-presenting this event tonight. Besides festivals, we run the second Saturday's reading series here in New York, a monthly literary salon held in various private homes. We have featured Vijay Sashadri, Monique Truong, James Hanaham, and Amanda Lee Koh. In the upcoming season, Claudia Soraya, Naomi Novik, and Chinolo Okparanta will be reading. We are very excited to be bringing that festival and the reading series, together with our arts blog and our boutique press, into a new literary nonprofit to be called Singapore Unbound. It is perhaps better described as a movement rather than a literary nonprofit, because it is powered by the movement of people and ideas between our two countries, Singapore and the United States. You can read all about this new movement in the festival program. We're pleased to offer a new fellowship to be called Singapore Unbound Fellowship to one student or recent graduate. The successful applicant will help with program development, event organizing, and social media. Please get in touch if you're interested. Singapore Unbound is also the theme of this year's festival. Singapore is a very small country in many ways. Throughout the history, even before the arrival of the British, in the period of Malay political rule and Bugis trade prominence, Singapore has always looked beyond its shores for the exchange of goods and ideas. Last night, we had a wonderful opening night at the Asian American Writers Workshop, talking about race and sex. Tonight, we have four amazing writers. You can talk to writers tonight about those topics too. Tonight, we have four amazing writers, and we're so pleased to have them. Alfian Sa'at, Gina Apostol, Jeremy Tiang, and Jessica Hagedorn, who will read and discuss the fictionalization of Southeast Asia in their work. Tomorrow, we have a lunchtime event on translation and a tea time event on crime writing at NYU. At night, we will enjoy a presentation of new theatrical works by Alfian, Ovidia Yu, and Marcus Yi at the National Opera Center. Finally, on Saturday, in a book culture bookstore near Columbia, a panel comprising a comics writer, a comics editor, an art historian, and the founder of TalkingCock.com, and that's a Singaporean reference, will come together to discuss the New York Times best-selling graphic novel, The Art of Charlie Chan Hock Chai, by the Singaporean graphic novelist Sunny Liu. The details of all the events are in your booklet, so please join us for the other events too. We're very, very pleased and honored to have Harold Augenbraum to moderate tonight's event. For 12 years, Harold was executive director of the National Book Foundation, the presenter of the National Book Awards. He translated the Filipino novelist Jose Rizal and edited the collected poems of Marcel Proust. So please put your hands together and welcome Harold.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. And I have lots of questions that I prepared, but I think Jessica just wants to talk about sex. So so I'll throw the questions out and we'll just do that, okay? Jessica and I have known each other for a long time, so I wouldn't say that about anybody else on the panel, but I feel comfortable saying that about you.
Thank you, Harold.
You're welcome. I'd like to thank G for all the help that he's given us for putting together this panel, and at the Asia Society, Rachel Cooper and Anne Kirkup for all the work that they've done, and for the introduction for Boone. I think that's was really wonderful to hear that and all the things that the Asia Society is doing. As you may have seen from the program, what we're going to focus on tonight is boundaries. And boundaries is going to be defined in a very broad way. And it's actually perfect for our four writers. The four writers come from an area of the world that is based very much in archipelagos. And if there is one thing that archipelagos have, that's boundaries. They're natural boundaries. But there are also boundaries, different types of boundaries that can be created by a variety of different events and cultures that exist on those islands. These writers have all dealt with boundaries in their works and in their lives, social, artistic, and political constructs of boundaries, and they've dispensed with them in many cases. If you've read their work, you can see how they're working with boundaries, working through boundaries, and denying boundaries in many ways. These boundaries can exist in the administrative areas, familial, linguistic, skin color, and racial, economic, cultural, and even concepts of taste. So this is how we're going to do the evening. I'm going to introduce each writer, and that writer will come up and read from his or her work. Then at the end, after all four writers have read, we will take our places. Actually, for the writers, just so you know, after you read, please take your seat here. Just take a seat on the stage, and you can sit here and listen to the other readers. I think it'll be easier than all four of us coming up later. So when you finish reading, take a seat there. I am going to sit at the end and come back up and introduce people. We are going to have a discussion about boundaries and about their lives and their work, and then we will open up to questions from the audience, so save up your questions. And afterwards, as Boone said, there'll be a book signing and reception in the back, so buy books, read the books, and we're on to the first writer. Jessica Hagedorn is the author of four novels, Toxicology, Dream Jungle, The Gangster of Love, and Dog Eaters. Dog Eaters was a seminal event, actually, in American writing, and it was a finalist for the National Book Award in 1990. She was also a board member later on of the National Book Foundation, where we served together when I was the executive director. She's also a playwright. And she goes back to the heady days of San Francisco in the 1970s, right? When things were 1960s. Things were tough, but things were really, really boogieing at the time. And I think it was quite a. And she has not recovered. So I'd like to welcome her and her reading. Please welcome Jessica Hagedorn.
Thank you, Harold. And thank you to the audience for allowing us to do this repartee. And I must say, I'm really honored to be part of your festival, G, and it was great to work with Rachel again, and to meet the two writers that we're all going to talk tonight, since you're also playwrights, and to meet you, Boone, because I love your name. It was an honor, and it's great to see a lot of friends in the audience. It's really lovely. I'm going to read from Dog Eaters two very short excerpts. They go together, actually, I believe, in the boundary conversation. The first is a little historical tract that I found when I was doing research for this book. And I found it so like a little masterpiece of irony. And I'm going to use it to introduce the excerpt I'm going to read from a chapter called Heroine. But this one comes right before it in the novel, and I think it's a perfect sort of little prologue. President William McKinley addresses a delegation of Methodist churchmen, 1898. I thought first we would take only Manila, then Luzon, then other islands, perhaps also. I walked the floor of the White House night after night until midnight. And I am not ashamed to tell you, gentlemen, that I went down on my knees and prayed Almighty God for light and guidance more than one night. And one night it came to me this way, I don't know how it was, but it came. One, that we could not give them back to Spain, that would be cowardly and dishonorable. Two, that we could not turn them over to France or Germany, our commercial rivals in the Orient. That would be bad business and discreditable. Three, that we could not leave them to themselves. They were unfit for self-government, and they would soon have anarchy and misrule over there, worse than Spain's was. And four, that there was nothing left for us to do but to take them all and to educate the Filipinos and uplift and civilize and Christianize them, and by God's grace do the very best we could by them as our fellow men for whom Christ also died. And then I went to bed and went to sleep and slept soundly. So, fast forward to the fabulous 1970s in Manila, and I'm going to read a little excerpt from a chapter called Heroin. Joey Sands. Do you like it? Like a crooner, don't you think? That's where I got my last name, the Sands, a casino in Las Vegas. This old drunk fuck was telling me about it. Hey, little pretty black boy, I ain't seen nothing like you since I left Detroit. He couldn't get over it, touched me when he got the chance. Did I have a daddy? Was my daddy an American? Shit, I laughed back at him, imitating his drawl. She it, man, I said, mocking him. You must be kidding. Man, I don't even have a mother. Laying it on real thick so he'd feel sorry for me. He started coming around Cocorico all the time. I'd be at the bar up front checking things out. Actually, he wasn't bad looking. When he wasn't drunk, his face and eyes didn't droop as much, and you'd notice his big body and muscular arms, pretty strong and firm for a man his age. I'd always act surprised to see him. That was before the disco craze, before I talked Andres into hiring me as a DJ for the back room. What do I need you for? Andres used to say, pointing to the jukebox. It seemed like forever before Andres let me give it a shot. And look at him now. He's making money. The place is jammed until all hours of the night. Even girls want to come here and dance. The music is so good. You're kind of young, aren't you? The American once observed. But I could tell he was fascinated, just like the rest of them. Joey Tabu, my head of tight, kinky curls, my pretty hazel eyes, my sleek brown skin. Where's the little GI baby, he'd ask Andres if I wasn't around. Andres would shrug in that bored way of his. He'll be here any moment now, I'm sure. The American would buy more drinks, sitting close by the door. Sometimes I'd get there, let him buy me dinner. Sometimes I'd just stay away. Call me Neil, he said, his eyes fixed on me in that sad, funny way of his. It was one of his sober days. Neil? What kind of name is that? I loved making fun of him. Good sport, he'd laugh with me, jabbing at his own chest with one of his large hands. I spit on the floor in contempt. Man, you don't have to talk to me like I don't know anything. Puede ba, good sport, I mimic, rolling my eyes. What do you think this is, the Lone Ranger and Tonto? I sulk, look away from him. Scan the room for a pretty face. Make him feel real bad. One time he asked me a favor for my buddy, some younger guy named Phil. I didn't like Phil as soon as I met him. Phil wants to see a live show. Phil is standing there next to Neil, staring at me, not saying anything. You mean a sex show? I take my time drinking my beer, ignoring Phil's piercing gaze. Yeah, that's right, one of those. Neil is uncomfortable. Andres stands behind the bar within earshot. He seems absorbed in the magazine he's reading, another article about his rich cousin. But I know Andres, one ear's cocked in our direction. You want boys, girls, or both? Maybe you want children? How much? It's the first and only time Phil opens his mouth. Depends, I say. I'll negotiate with Uncle privately. Take my cut. We have a car, Neil says. We drive down Rojas Boulevard slowly, looking for the street. It's early, around 11 at night. I sit in the front seat with Neil, giving directions. Across the boulevard, I can see Manila Bay, black and still. Is that your ship? I point to the ghostly carrier floating in the middle of the dark sea. The men don't respond. Uncle's waiting for us with Emiliano, the night watchman, hired by Congressman Abad to guard his property from vandals and thieves. Uncle deals with me directly, talking in Tagalog and ignoring the two white men. He orders Emiliano to stay outside to watch the car after I tell Neil, give Emiliano money. The abandoned Lido Supper Club, a white building with fake marble columns, statues of half-naked nymphs hold unlit torches. Uncle ushers us in through the back door. It's cavernous inside and eerie. There is a thick coat of dust on everything we touch. Uncle looks for the main switch, stumbling, pointing his flashlight at the cobwebs on the walls. Finally, he turns on the dim chandelier. He motions to a table in the front row facing a large stage. Not too long ago, Johnny Buenaventura and his amazing orchestra used to play The Girl from Ipanema here. Now, a bare mattress lies dead center, a roll of toilet paper and a bottle of alcohol next to it. I leave the two Americans at the table, take Uncle aside, tell him what they want. He is gone approximately 10 minutes. A skinny young girl enters, followed by a well-built young man, close to my age. She wears a flimsy, loose-fitting dress, her eyes lowered. She is barefoot. The young man is also barefoot. He wears khaki pants, nothing else. There are intricate tattoos of spiders and cobwebs up and down his sinewy body. A weeping Madonna tattooed across his back. He is beautiful. The two Americans sit up in their chairs, attentive now. I stay in the back of the cavernous room, smoking my cigarette in the shadows. This way, I can watch them all. The two Americans, the young girl with her face turned away, the young man with the magnificent tattoos. Uncle has quietly disappeared. When it is over, the young man looks up at the white men while the girl tears off some toilet paper, dabs it in alcohol, and wipes herself off. Okay, boss? The young man asks eagerly, grinning at the stunned Americans. You want us to do that again? Thank you.
Well, if you haven't read Dog Eaters, that's a really good piece to hear. You should definitely buy it and read it. Our next reader is Alfian Sa'at. He is a resident playwright with Wild Rice, one of Singapore's most recognized theater companies. He's been nominated 8 times for Best Original Script. He Best Original Script at the Life Theater Awards, and he won it in 2005 for Landmarks. In 2013, he won the Bo Cameronian Award for the Best Original Script for the play Para. He's published 3 collections of poetry, a collection of short story, and a collection of flash fiction. I'm not sure it's really flash fiction, but these short pieces that are really, really beautiful and just tear at your heartstrings, every one that you read. You read them in 5 minutes, and they really are very, very gripping, and then you go on to the next one, and the next one, it happens again and again and again and again. And it's a wonderful piece of work of the way it's been put together, in addition to beautiful writing. So it gives me great pleasure to welcome Alfian Sa'at.
Hello. Thank you so much to the Asia Society, as well as Ji Leong, for this event. I'm going to read a few very short stories from this collection, which is called Malay Sketches. Malay Sketches, incidentally, is also the name of a book by a colonial administrator called Frank Swettenham. One reason I named this book this way is that so when you go to Google and you put Malay Sketches, hopefully I come out rather than him, because that is a work of rather obscene colonial observations about Malays, including their flat noses and their lazy behavior. Okay, so the first story I'm going to read is called a Hantu Tete story. I know some people are giggling. You're probably Singaporean. Hantu is ghost and Tete is breast. So, a Hantu Tete story. As she held the X-rays in her hand, Sarima remembered the story of the Hantu Tete, the buxom ghost who prowled at dusk and killed children by placing their heads between her breasts. What a way to perish, nose squashed against sternum, ears walled in by hot, yeasty flesh. Snuffed out like a candle between forefinger and thumb, death spelt the pair of double Ds. Her mind turned towards forensic speculation. What was the nature of the death? How long did one struggle in the darkness before being plunged into a deeper oblivion? She had once read a newspaper article about an American who suffered a concussion after his head was smacked by the knockers of a lap dancer. Subsequently, he had sued her for damages. Maybe this was the case with the Hantu Tete. Pectoral boulders which it used to crush delinquent skulls, those truants still playing hide-and-seek, even after the twilight prayer call, to adults a summons, to children a warning, had long exhaled its final notes. Sarima considered how it was the morphology of the breast which ultimately decided the mode of homicide. Maybe there was no tissue in them at all. They were pure muscle, reptilian, flecked with fungal patches of scales, and they could constrict the child's head, squeezing the carotids like grapes. The Hantu's nipples seeking out one another to be united in an autoerotic serpent's kiss. If not muscular, then cystic, globes stretched thin by gallons of fluid, streaked with veins like river charts on a map. Asphyxiation, all the victim's pores buttered up, nostrils plugged by slug-like extensions, blobs of gelatine. Or perhaps a more profound death, a mystery hidden in the cleavage of the Hantu Tete. A red glow, porthole portal, a landscape from the point of view of an embryo, promising eternal warmth, deliverance from a night filled with the chilly shouts of parents and a guaranteed spanking at home. Unlike the boys in her kampong, which is village, Sarima did not believe the power of the Hantu Tete was in her overt carnality. Unlike the Pontiana, the soft-spoken, tombstone-cradling seductress who exuded sex from her hair and frangipani from her paws. Hantu Tete practiced no gender discrimination. Boys and girls were equal prey, as long as they had strayed beyond the magic circle bounded by the front yard and the clock's hands. Moreover, didn't a mother tell Sarima that the Hantu Tete's breasts were monstrosities, putrid hives of maggots? A paradox then, a mortal ghost with breasts that kept on rotting but never towards complete disintegration. This then was the Hantu Tete's torment and the source of her malevolence, that the only organs on her body showing signs of life were the ones that were undergoing eternal putrefaction. Cells budding only to decay the next second. It was anybody's idea of hell to be revived and then tortured, resurrected and put through unimaginable pain. To be alive means to be dying. It was a fact that Sarima was getting used to, a universal truth she had to acknowledge, especially now. Sarima held an X-ray, or more specifically a mammogram, against the window. Those radiolucent patches, what the doctors called calcifications, became brighter, inflamed. With almost a cry of dismay, Sarima scanned the phantom-like patches. She held her mammogram higher towards the light. She saw ghosts, brazen and invincible, immune to the powers of sunlight and prayer. Thank you. Just one more short one. This is called Village Radio. When I first entered Boksu's house, the first thing I noticed was an ornate birdcage hung near a window. There was a spotted dove cooing inside. Another birdcage hung next to it, but it was empty. I asked Boksu how he managed to catch the bird. "From the jungle," was his terse reply. I wanted him to elaborate. Did he set a trap and could I see one? Boksu looked at me incredulously. "All you have to do is open the cage door, and one will fly in." It was my turn to be incredulous. Did he perhaps lay some bait inside the cage? Boksu turned his attention to the dove, making clucking noises at it. I was getting quite tired with his mystifications. This was what was considered the wisdom of village people, and I began to see that it was built on secrecy and evasion. Exasperated and not getting straight answers, I asked Boksu, "Don't you think that it's wrong to keep birds like that? Shouldn't they be allowed to fly freely?" Boksu turned towards me. He smiled and said, "You come from the city, where you have radios to keep you company. But I have this dear bird to fill my house with music." I thought there was something unfortunate about having to imprison an animal merely for entertainment, but I held my tongue. Anyway, he had already drawn a line putting me in my place. What did I know as a city person about how these village dwellers furnish their solitude? A few months lapsed before I returned to Terengganu. This time, both cages in Poksu's house were empty. I asked him what happened to the dove. Poksu merely smiled and brought me to the kitchen. He showed me his brand new transistor radio. Then his wife served us some tea with Jacob's cream crackers. Throughout the 6 days that I stayed with him, Boksu never once turned on the radio. He would instead sit in the living room, smoking and staring at his two empty cages. His head was itself a cage. In the cage was a jungle, and in the jungle was music, private and far away. Thank you.
Extraordinary. Everyone is that good. Everyone. Gina Apostol is our next reader. Her most recent novel is Gun Dealer's Daughter. It won the 2013 Penn Open Book Prize Award and was shortlisted for the 2014 William Saroyan International Prize. Her two novels, Bibliolepsy and The Revolution According to Raimundo Mata, both won the Juan Laya Prize for the novel, and that's the Philippine National Book Award. She was a writer in residence at Phillips Exeter Academy and a fellow at the Civitiella Ranieri in Umbria, among many other fellowships. And I do have to say, she gets the prize for best dressed tonight. Welcome, Gina Apostol.
Thank you so much, Asia Society, and thank you so much, Harold. I'm such a fan of Harold's work because he translated Rizal, and I am absolutely obsessed by Jose Rizal. I'm going to read from Gun Dealer's Daughter, and I'll just start reading. My doctors say they're a bit cuckoo, I'll admit, one of them fairly run down himself, that cases of anterograde amnesia are common in traumatic instances. A senile diagnosis. How can it be amnesia if one remembers even the terms for herbs or the shine of someone's shoes? But this is my case, the doctors say. I carry phantom, mnemonic cargo, nauseous waves of memory. I shore them up by words. I've been given the medical term for intermittent clarity, these strikes of lucidity upon which memory invokes its pathetic fallacies, hyperthemistic scenes, with lacunar phases. the mind, at the best of times, is a ruinous house with traps. Language plays its part, the doctors say. Above all, words are symptoms. I must be alert. Even one's vocabulary could be a crime. The way sounds repeat themselves, assonance, odd lines and slant rhymes, repetition, the site of trauma. Repetition is the site of trauma, the doctors repeat. Beware the Asian mariner, the lady with the albatross, or the Singapore peony. Words have their own way with you. Be careful. Allusion, ditto. Consonants, epistrophe, chiasma, miasma, ditto, 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 ditto. But I kept practicing, and sometimes I felt I could become whole. Words were everyone's crutch, anyone's accomplice. I told the aging quack doctor, is it not so that it is language that will save me? This work I am doing right now could become a hesitant, crepitating talambuhay, a reckoning, a confession. The doctor just kept coughing, looking for something, a slipper, the cat that got his tongue hiding under a rug. Bunch of useless geriatrics. True, he could be right. Reckoning may be too strong a word. And to what was I confessing? Who was to blame? The doctor kept scratching at his throat, coaxing out with scrawny fingers his furtive phlegm. The strange thing was, when the day came that I could write whole paragraphs, tentative, one-storied stories, linked sentences in a coherent void, my vertigo stopped. Room stabilized. Objects stayed in place. This gun dealer's daughter's name is Soledad Soliman, and she's trying to figure out what happened to her because she can't remember anything. And yet she has a lot of memories. This paradox is really weird for her, anterograde amnesia. So I'm going to read one of those memories that she's trying to write out. I admit that I had liked the experience of sitting still in Manila's torpor while she had painted in our living room. I had liked the pleasant effort of repose, a kind of introspective challenge. My mother, posing stiff-backed beside me, kept lapsing into her hostess fluttering, offering cakes and juices to the artist as she worked, though Madame Vieira barely answered, speaking only to correct our poses. Madame Vieira was an emaciated Spaniard of a remarkable hue. Stale, dry glue comes close to her pallor, a glutinous texture of gray. On the first day, she had appeared at our doorway in Makati in fur and a venerable silk suit, a corrugated glistening that trailed the musty smell and mothball stench of some theatrical company's dank costume department. Every day, she wore the same kind of suit, like some outlaw from an ancient dry cleaner's. I watched her pull off her gloves while the maid buzzed my mother. Madame Vieira's rings supported her fingers rather than the other way around. It seemed to me the rings kept her flesh in place. I imagined that her entire body was precariously meshed, held together by the same miserable flesh that one saw on her freed hands, a veined, brittle hide in an advanced stage of molting. Waiting with her in the living room, I imagined, as she pulled off a late glove, that if one pulled hard enough, one could rip her skin off, and she'd emerge from the shell of her body like a cicada. She did not look at me, but at the furnishings of our house. She stood up to imagine the amor solo. Rose-cheeked women selling flowers in a fresh meat market. She muttered, I suppose, to me, "That picture's nothing. Just wait till you see my nyeh." She had a gargling nasal accent, but I believe she spoke in English. I'm not so sure of what she said. As I said, it was pleasing to sit for a portrait, as if I were giving up my duties to someone else, some obligation, the obligation of self-study, one might put it. I delegated so much of my daily existence. She's a daughter of gun dealers, so she's really, really, really wealthy. There was always a personal servant, a driver, a cook, baker, gardener, floral designer, including a personal dog groomer who used to come on scheduled visits to redecorate my pets, a sweet pair of alpine pinschers, now dead, victims of some rank methane plague. Their mystifying gassiness expelled them from paradise, and I sobbed over their loss. So it was no giant step to surrender my idea of myself to someone else's expertise. Even my mother relaxed, silent, forgetting her posture so often that Madame Viera barked, "Siéntate." My mother would apologize sitting up. In fact, my mother had been in Madame Viera's thrall. I couldn't explain it. At first, I resented my mother's obedience to this hag of a Picasso. My mother was often prey to a procession of hacks, foreigners whom Manila attracted the way the wet season draws moths indoors. That's how she almost had our entire garden replanted to put blocking wind trees in the appropriate spiritual corners upon the advice of a lightweight Westerner whom Mr. Kao Lung, the rightful feng shui master, denounced when he came back from Hong Kong. That's how we acquired gigantic gold leaf murals in the private den when she fell to the folly of a debonair Frenchman, a passing interior decorator who soon after romped off with someone's bank account and teenage child. That's how we got our portraits painted, a frothy extravaganza of fragonard wisps and the hazy perspective in the background of what seemed to be a miniature palace, a schematic design Madame Viera had already practiced for all of her previous clients, especially the fantastic couple in Delusional Clouds. That's how, in the frozen eternity of oils, I miraculously acquired prominent cheekbones and, most wondrously, a chin. And my mom gained the height of Venus de Milo, rising from a puka shell. Madame Viera had painted us with the most awkward clairvoyance, sketching what she sensed our fantasies to be, an embarrassing wish fulfillment. I understand to one lady's furnishings, she had added the lion's emblem of the old viceroy of Mexico, though the only viceregal thing about the subject were her vacant eyes. She looked like a blind pug going up in smoke. For the portrait of the couple, her biggest patrons, Madame Viera had added the mythic complications of tropical Genesis, brown Adam and Eve rising to pink and blue clouds from split bamboo. She had smoothed the man's lupus into a lapidary plumpness and had restored to the other her winsome youth. In my opinion, in Madame Viera's heaven, they seemed to wallow, like my unfortunate dogs, in some hissy, flatulent eternity. Madame Viera was not so much a painter as a pander. In the inferno, easily should be a sinner in lower hell, condemned to eternal lashings from horned demons. In Manila, she had found an ideal world for her talents. When I saw the painting, I knew I had been right to fear for my mother's goodwill, that some awful discovery of bad taste would come about from this misguided aesthetic project. When Madame Viera unveiled her prize, she hadn't allowed us to see the piece in progress, and I, for one, didn't bother to look. I felt as if I had been smacked, caught in an insult. My cheeks burned as I looked at my unrecognizable self, my smoothed-out nose, my pink, sculpted cheeks, and most of all, my blameless chin. I was caught in my hideous dream of perfectly symmetrical beauty. Madame Viera was standing in a corner, watching us. She still clutched pieces of the frame's wrapping in her avian arms. I imagine she was leering at us in the beaky way of an unevolved creature, a vertical pterodactyl, some ave de rapina. I felt sodden, spit upon. As my mother came closer to look at the painting, I stepped forward as if to shield her from the insult. My mother took a breath. "Viera, what can I say?" my mother said. I knew she was going to speak it, my anger and embarrassment at the painter's dishonesty. "It's marvelous," my mother continued. "You captured my soul at just the right angle. Finding her beauty so wonderfully, that mold of your chin, darling, she did it so well. Look, and I can't say that you didn't do so badly with my own self. I do like the coloring. It's so lifelike. I can't wait to show it to my husband, Frankie." Madame Viera clapped her hands at this, rattling her rings. "Oh, hush, hush, Queenie. It's all in the subject. I just draw. I'm a vessel." I looked at both of them. I looked back at the painting, at my mother. Madame Viera showed us where she thought she could do some last revisions in the refined shadowing of an ear, the adjustment of light about a head, and that was that. She asked permission to exhibit the work in her show that year. 1980, it took the capital by storm, as the papers like to say. The last I knew, the picture had been installed on the mezzanine, a reception hall in the house in Makati, the house my parents were dismantling right now as they set their bright new hopes for a new life in the oasis they were building in that new place in Alabang. Thank you.
That was terrific. I remember when that book came out, and the publicist actually called me on the phone and said, "I'm sending you this book. You have to read it." I mean, because it's absolutely marvelous. Jeremy Tiang's short story collection, "It Never Rains on National Day," which he's going to be reading from, was shortlisted for the Singapore Literature Prize. He has had work appear in the Guardian, Esquire, Brooklyn Rail, Ambit, the Asia Literary Review, and Singaporean Short Stories, and he won Singapore's Golden Point Award. He has been awarded an NEA Literary Translation Fellowship, a Henry Luce Foundation Fellowship, many, many other fellowships and awards, and he is also a translator. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome Jeremy Tiang.
Thank you, Harold, and thanks to the Asia Society for having us. I'm going to read from It Never Rains on National Day, a collection of stories about Singaporeans outside of Singapore, as well as outsiders within Singapore. In this story, Sophia's aunt, a Singaporean woman, finds her life put on hold in Beijing, where her British husband is waiting to have a heart transplant. When doctor's words confound Sophia's patchy Mandarin, she says, "Pardon?" But he just grows unhelpfully louder. Finally, she says, "Wait, wait," and calls her aunt. As the phone rings, she imagines the aunt's ungainly progress through the camphorous apartment, catching her knee on the rosewood armchair, swearing in pungent bursts. A click and muffled thud as the aunt pulls at the cord and demands breathlessly, "Yes?" "I don't know what doctor wants. Can you ask him?" Sophia has learned that her aunt regards hellos and how are yous as wasted words, wasted time. She hands the phone to doctor and they squawk away again. Both have Beijing accents, their voices arch and slurred. Her head aches. The noise is amplified by the narrow corridor, which smells not of antiseptic as a hospital should, but of concrete and radiator dust. Doctor slots the phone back into her hand as if she were a wall socket and marches away. She lifts it to her ear, but the aunt has already hung up. Nicholas is watching television when she comes in, although he can't understand a word of Chinese. He claims to follow the sense, but she thinks he just wants a voice in the room. She has left him a small stack of index cards on which her aunt has written, "Bring water," or "Turn down heating." A chaste kiss, as always, and then she begins pulling containers from her bags. Over Sophia's protests, the aunt insisted on doing the cooking. "Your cooking is the reason he's sick," she retorted, and there was enough truth in that to silence Sophia. She still remembers the consultant after his first collapse talking about hypertension, the silent killer, blaming stress as well as too much fat and salt, and her guilty recollection of all those steaks fried in butter, all that French patisserie. When Nicholas has had enough, the food goes back into the tote bags it arrived in, boxes slotting neatly together, cutlery wrapped in a paper towel. She pours him some tea from a thermos and blows to cool it before touching it to his lips. In the first days, she felt the need to keep up a stream of chat filling the dead air. Now she sees that her presence is enough. She reads him an article from The Economist, something about Elizabeth Warren, which he snorts at, a glimpse of his old self. "We're so lucky Guma brought us here," says Sophia ritualistically for perhaps the 10th time, unsure whether she is trying to arouse gratitude in herself or merely appear grateful so the universe will not take even this chance away from them. "Yes," says Nicholas, "very lucky." They could never on their own have negotiated their way into this hospital, not without the aunt to speak to certain people, to scribble her way through swaths of paperwork with the elan of someone who's lived her life within a low-tech bureaucracy. It is a relief when nurse comes to tell her to please leave, come again tomorrow. Sophia kisses her husband's dry lips and joins the families clustering in the hallways, laughing and shouting at children to stop running. Her insides are heavy, as if the grey outside sky has taken up residence in her. She is somehow unable to fit into the rhythm of the people around her and keeps getting bumped into. Her phone rings as she reaches the car park. She knows it will be the aunt and breathes in-out rapidly 3 times before pressing answer. Guma? Finished? Can't pick you up today. Meeting. The aunt has a lot of meetings. Sophia has not been able to decipher what these might be, something to do with work or the party? She does not want to know. That's fine, she says. I'll take a taxi. She remembers to use the proper Mandarin word, jicheng che, not the Singaporean de she, a bastardization of the English. Don't tell the driver where you're from. Sophia sighs. Don't worry, I'll just say I'm from the south. The aunt is certain that all Beijing taxi drivers will overcharge her mercilessly if they find out she is foreign. I don't know what time I'll be back. Don't wait for me to eat. Yes, Sophia hesitates, but the words bubble up. Guma, will he be all right? The aunt sniffs. Don't worry for nothing. Old Cheng will do a good job. He's done so many hearts over the years. For him, it's just like putting a new battery into your alarm clock. Old Cheng is the former colleague. Sophia isn't very sure about how they are connected. Campmates during re-education? Something like that. Thank you, says Sophia to the click of the aunt hanging up. The sky is inky blue as she walks round to the front of the building. The roadside trees are sharp silhouettes. She thinks of the Chinese word qing, which means something between black and green, the exact colour of a tree at dusk. That was a good phone call, she considers. Talking to the aunt is an obstacle course, especially with her limited Mandarin. She counts a conversation successful if it passes without real awkwardness on either side. It doesn't help that she barely knows the aunt. Their families were only able to get back in touch after China opened its borders in the 80s. She has a childhood memory of a loud-voiced woman visiting once, her clothes plain and washed thin, smelling of unaired rooms. She is in her 60s now. A squat figure with formidable powers of persuasion. It can't have been easy being a female doctor, and perhaps this is why the aunt never married. Sophia knows she should show an interest, but can't find the energy to ask these questions, to find out some of what the last 50 years have been like. And there are always more pressing things to discuss. Nicholas's food, Nicholas's medicine. She remembers her father once saying something about high-powered friends, about how she could have risen higher if not for political factions. But this is all part of the wall of unknowing that now surrounds Sophia. China, the aunt's past, Nicholas's illness, each overwhelming, too large to contemplate or unpick. Outside the hospital is a sculpture on a tall pedestal. High overhead, 2 bronze hands, each the size of a man's head, clasp each other, the lower hand clearly being pulled out of some danger. The upper hand is fringed with the edge of a sleeve, on which it is just possible to make out the emblem of a 5-pointed star, heraldic leaves below it. Her own hands clasped for warmth. Sophia stands by the road. Even though winter is supposed to be on its way out, the air is chilly. She shivers as she checks that she still has all her bags. A man is selling roasted chestnuts nearby, his brazier exuding charred, smoky fumes. If only I could be saved, she thinks, stretching her arm out into the road to stop a taxi. Thank you.
Yeah, let's make sure our microphones are on. Or can you hear me in the back there and everything? Okay, thank you. Those are great readings. Thank you to everybody for doing those readings and beautiful language more than anything else. I think it's just stunning, absolutely stunning. And that's actually how I want to begin. One of the interesting aspects about pairing two Filipino writers and two Singaporean writers is that, correct me if I'm wrong, but English is really the de facto national, second national language of each of these places. And they come from colonial past. So that brings up a couple of different things. One is, and I think you probably heard that in Gina's reading, the idea of how language and culture affect the culture of the time now. I think you can hear that in all of them, but I think particularly in Gina's readings. So let's start a little bit with the context of language and how language and the choice of language in your writing affects you. But I want to start by contextualizing this. So I'm going to start by asking you each where exactly you were born and what language you spoke until you were 5 years old. Gina?
I was born in Leyte in the Philippines South. It's in the middle part of the Philippines, middle set of islands, the eastern part, and I spoke Waray.
I was born in Manila, and until five?
Until five.
You are so far out. well, we sort of spoke three languages in the house, English, Spanish, and Tagalog.
Mm. Did any of them dominate?
Depends which adult was talking, if it was which grandparent, or if it was my mother or my father, or one of the other people in the house, like an auntie or a servant or something. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and then you just fluidly move through it. I mean, I remember thinking it wasn't, you know, I sort of loved it. And then as I got older, it got less. I mean, I felt like school did something else to me.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll talk about that in a minute. Yeah. Alfian?
I was born in Singapore is so tiny, so there's no like other state or whatever. But the name of the hospital that I was born in, it's called Kandang Kerbau, which in Malay means buffalo pen. In fact, it's the main maternity hospital in Singapore. We're all buffaloes, and I spoke mostly Malay until five because my parents were both came from Malay vernacular schools, but they also mixed it up, peppered it a little bit with English, but predominantly Malay until five.
And you translate from Malay into Malay now, right?
From Malay to English.
From Malay to English. Jeremy?
I too was born in Kandang Kerbau Hospital in Singapore, which is a reflection, I think, of how tiny Singapore is.
How many hospitals are there in Singapore?
One.
One.
Ten?
One.
Two.
Yeah. And I spoke primarily English, which is the only language my parents have in common. Occasionally, I spoke Cantonese with my mother, but was made to stop when I started school because Cantonese is not an official language in Singapore.
And you translate from Mandarin now, though?
The written forms of Chinese dialects are all the same, so I translate from Mandarin or Cantonese into English.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Let's start with you, Jessica. So you said that when you went to school, that changed your idea of language. How did it change your idea of language?
Well, this goes to show you the Jurassic age, you know, that I was growing up in. But I don't know how much it's changed. But we were, you know, our mutual friend, the writer Luis Francia, who was going to the boys' school while I was going to the all-girls school, we used to laugh about how the teachers would fine you if you didn't speak English. I think they were harder on the boys, you know. And you just were, like, to speak Tagalog, for example, was frowned upon, even though we did have a class in it, in which we read and wrote in it. But
we were supposed to really be these great English speakers. It was, you know, that was the language back then of lingua franca and everything else.
So it was a language of education, and is that how you
yes.
ended up writing? So
yes.
that's
and
that was your
Spanish
literary
was
language.
Already fading. I mean, that was like the, you know, the old time.
So English was your literary language from an early age when you started school?
I would say so, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And Alfian, how about you? I mean, you grew up speaking Malay.
Yeah, so I grew up speaking Malay until, like, I went into primary school, which is around 6 years old. And my mother, she practiced a form of social engineering by telling me, I don't want you to have Malay friends. Yeah.
Ooh. Yeah. So it gets worse and worse
really?
As we go
down. Yeah.
But the strategy was that if I had non-Malay friends, I would be forced to speak English with them. She just wanted me to be able to be better at English. But she also had this sort of a racial idea that she actually particularly wanted me to have Chinese friends because she said they were very good at maths. So this whole Chinese maths thing is universal, yeah, in Singapore and the model minorities in America. So and also this whole idea that there'd be some kind of like IQ osmosis or something. She didn't think very highly of me, I suppose, at that time. But yeah. But I think because of those interactions, I picked up English. I stayed away a lot from the Malay kids. I don't play soccer. That's why I didn't play soccer, because I stayed away from them. I don't play the guitar. I don't do a lot of things that young Malay boys do. So, yeah. So you win some, you lose
sad.
Some.
That's so sad.
So when did English become the language of choice for literature, though, for you?
For literature? I think because that became the language I thought in and conversed in with friends, then it also somehow became also the language I dreamed in. And I think once that starts happening, then you start writing in it as well.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Gina, what about you? When did you?
Well, actually, when I was around, I guess I lied, because I think I was around 4 when my mom, my father was in the States, and my mom followed him. And so we were in the States for a few years. And so I learned, I went to school, kindergarten, I think, or first, I'm not sure which one, in the States. And then my mom didn't like my dad, so she left him and then came back to the Philippines. And so I grew up in the Philippines. And
back in the Visayas?
Yeah, I went back to Leyte. So Waray is so very close to me, because when I came back to Leyte, no one wanted to talk to me, because it turns out I didn't speak Waray anymore when I got back. And I just felt that this was a language I wanted, and it's a language I kept. But English had become my the language of school. And of course, in the Philippines, it was, when I was growing up, still the language of school.
Would you consider, have you ever written in Waray?
I have. I write in Waray. I write letters in Waray. I write on Facebook in Waray. But I have not written stories in Waray.
Mm-hmm. I mean, there is that tradition, because, as you know, with Rizal, and this is something that we share, Rizal tried to write certain things in Tagalog and couldn't do it. After Spanish had become his lingua literatura, language of letters for him, he could not write, and he tried to write his third novel in Tagalog and couldn't do it. So, and it turned to Spanish. So, Jeremy, tell us about how, you know, you took on English as a literary language. I mean, it was your language from home, but you know, there's a political idea about this as well, isn't there?
Well, my parents are both big fans of colonialism. So I grew up in a house full of books, English books. Like, in my house, for my family, books are in English. That's the language books come in. Also, my grandfather ran an English language bookshop, which went bankrupt, and he distributed the stock among us. So the house is literally full of books. So I guess it took me till I got to school and went to the library to encounter books in Chinese. Mm. And I think that's true for many of us, that the language that you speak in, the language you hear around you, is different to the language that you see in books and the language that literature comes in.
Mm. Go ahead.
Just to say, you know, when I was growing up reading English, I was reading Filipino writers in English as well as, you know, Hemingway. So,
Did any of you actually resent the idea that English was the language of education and literature, and wish that you had taken on this literary language of your area, of your, you know, the pre-colonial, let's call it, area? I mean, did you long to have to be able to write in that other language?
I think that kind of longing didn't come till much later, because I just thought this wacky world I was growing up in was the way all the worlds were. I mean, you know, like when I finally came to the States, I was surprised that most people I met only spoke English. You know, I thought everyone was sort of cosmopolitan. What an idiot, you know. And it wasn't until I became less ignorant, you know, that I sort of politically, you know, it's like I was working on Dog Eaters and sort of, I was going, oh my God, my God, my God.
So what you're saying
is, all came together, kind of, you know things.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah. But what you're saying, in a way, is that trilingualism was your ignorance.
Well, I just thought that's how the world functions, because it made sense. Mm-hmm. You know?
Mm-hmm.
I also did question as a child why we were studying Tagalog as this sort of foreign language. Even I wasn't that much of an idiot. I'd sort of go, wait a minute, there's something really weird going on here. Mm-hmm. It was called colonialism, but I didn't know.
But I mean, that does have something to do with it. I mean, I think the most obvious, the most well-known part of that is that going into the English sector in, I think it was in Shanghai, that they had that sign that said, Chinese and dogs not allowed. Mm. And that's sort of the way linguistically a lot of these things go on, that, you know, colonialism has pushed out the local language in many ways, and you have to, if you want to get ahead, you have to use the language of colonialism.
Why is it always that poster? Because in California, they used to have posters, Filipinos and dogs not allowed.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a thing about the...
About dogs.
About dogs.
That's why I ate them. No,
there's your next book. There's your next book, Gina. The dog dealers. Alfian, you were nodding when we were talking about, you know, the idea of what language you chose and the politics of language when you're writing, because you do work in Malay as well, but not writing originally, right?
Yeah, I have to say though that in Singapore we have a bilingual education system. So as much as the medium of instruction in schools is English, we also take what is known as a mother tongue language. So Jeremy's was Mandarin.
Yes.
Mine was Malay. So there is still some link with that mother tongue, ancestral language, etc. Yeah, but I'd never really thought about why am I writing in English? Isn't it, you know, a colonial language? I never thought about these things until one day I put up an English play. A journalist from the Malay papers came up to me and she said, "Oh, you know, great play, but don't you want to write a Malay play?" She asked me. I said, "Why?" And she said, "Because you're Malay." And I was very young at that time. I was like 18 or something, and I really felt culturally blackmailed. And I succumbed, and I actually wrote a Malay play. Yeah, I was so susceptible to cultural blackmail. And but it was a struggle writing it, because it's really not my first natural language. So I'd be writing this plays with like a huge-ass bilingual dictionary in my lap all the time. But playwriting was helpful, because at least I could work with actors who could sort of smoothen out the dialogue and make it sound authentic.
Mm. And Jeremy, one of the things about your book in particular is that all of these Singaporeans go and they feel alienated from the cultures around them and the languages around them. I mean, a lot of this is about going someplace and you don't get the language. Where does that come from for you? Is there that alienation that you're exploring in the book, the linguistic alienation?
I think as someone who is mixed race and whose parents speak completely different languages, meaning they have to communicate in English, I've always felt slightly alienated, both in Singapore and then when I left first in the UK and then here. And it's quite good not having anywhere that you really feel you belong. It allows you to have a certain dispassionate eye, whatever you're looking at. And I think there is this myth, both here and in Singapore, of cultural purity, and of the idea of a homogeneous culture, of certain markers, this is American, this is Singaporean. But if you've never felt you've belonged, then that leads you to interrogate from an early age those terms and to ask, well, I don't belong. Does anyone? Is everyone else just faking it?
Yes.
Yes.
Everybody else is faking it. Let me ask you about how your books are received back in the Philippines and Singapore, because you're removed from there now, very much removed from there now. So how are they received there?
I have no idea. I mean, it wins awards. And mm-hmm. all of my books have won some kind of award. Two of them won two awards. But I don't know if I'm read, actually. Actually, every so often, I'm read. So I know that. There is a strong tradition of Filipino writing in English. Mm-hmm. And the Nikwakin book is going to come out from Penguin Classics next year. I mean, I grew up just loving Filipino writing in English. So in one sense, English for me is also the world of Franz Arcelliana. It's also the world of Nick Joaquin. It's also the world of Jose Garcia Villa. So I don't know, in terms of how it's received in the Philippines, my own work.
But it's read.
I hope it is, because everyone keeps sending me their goddamn thesis or dissertation.
But you also, one of the things you have, there is a tradition in the Philippines of exploring the grotesque, let's call it, mm-hmm. in literature. Mm-hmm. And you do that in mm-hmm. your book. And there is a long history of that, certainly, mm-hmm. I'd say 100-year history mm-hmm. at least, mm-hmm. of exploring the grotesque. And have you gotten bad reactions from people in the Philippines from being somewhat of an outsider and then exploring the grotesque in the Philippines?
No, I don't think so. I think sometimes some people have said something about the way I would use language. I hate to talk about the critics, so you know, my own critics, but I would use language, and you want it to be closer to the people. You know, you want it. I mean, gun dealer, she's an asshole elitist person. So she's going to use language in a particular way, and that's why I use language that way. I don't use language all the time that way, because someone who's going to be, you know, a schoolgirl in Sampaloc is going to be somewhat different from a girl who grew up in a mansion in Manila, New York, and France. So language for me changes. The way I use language will change depending on the story.
Mm. Jessica, what about you? I mean, you I know are read in the Philippines, but especially Dog Eaters, right? And but what was the criticism? Because that was a pretty
super,
rough book.
Yeah. Well, the title really made people crazy.
Yeah.
But I think, you know, I see it as a real love and real hate. There are those people who are super supportive readers, and there are certain critics who are always very supportive and who seem to really get my work, which is wonderful. And I'm sure there are those people who really have no time for my work or who look down on it because I'm an outsider. You know, it's the old she laughed and who is she to write about mm-hmm. where we live anymore, which is, you know, it's fine. You don't have to love me. And
I love you.
Sounds like a song.
We love you, Jessica.
Yeah. No. I mean, you know, it used to have a sting for me when I was younger, but now I've, you know, realized as an older writer that's okay. It also means there's a dialogue going on. And, you know, the students I've met there, I was there 2 years ago, the young students who are reading our work are so darn smart and spend so much time, and it matters to them. And I think there is a real curiosity there about what we're doing in this part of the world. And I always wish that we had as much curiosity about the writers there. And I really try to, give attention to the, there's so many good writers in the Philippines, actually. nobody really knows about them here. I mean, the love is one-sided. You know, even if they're not crazy about your work, they're going to read it because they want to be up on what's going on.
And it's interesting with all of you, too, is because you come from places where people write originally in English. So it's not as if they even have to be translated.
No.
So then people could read them.
But it's about who's living there and who dares to write about it.
But I think it would be probably better for us if we were ventriloquized by the translator of Elsa Ferrante.
You're right, that notion that because
we're in English and it's not translated,
yeah.
you know, and that the, I mean, yeah, I'm reading Eka Korniawa right now, and it's amazing. I mean, but he wrote in, you know, Bahasa. So,
Alfian, about your reception in Singapore when you write in English. I mean, this book I think is the short pieces. I think you're really extraordinary and. In the different ways you were able to capture sentiment without ever being sentimental.
Mm-hmm.
What was the reception about that, especially since it really flies in the face of the whole idea of colonialism?
Right. There are very few writers of Malay ethnicity who write in English in Singapore. So actually for me to label, just give this title Malay Sketches is a bit of a risk because I feel I don't want to be a spokesperson. I feel I don't want to be the one, you know, that someone is going to put up as evidence that, okay, look, we have multicultural literature in Singapore, and we have a book called Malay Sketches, you know, and we also have another book called, I don't know, Indian Scrawlings, I don't know. So I'm kind of cautious of that kind of positionality, you know, and I wish there were more Malay writers writing English, because every time they ask me, hey, we want to include something you've written in an anthology, I always like, is it because I'm Malay? Is it because you need, you know, to tick those boxes? So I'm in a conflicted kind of position. Mm. At the same time, also, I want to not write about things that are overtly about ethnicity, but at the same time, I see that the ground, not so many people are doing that, so there's also that responsibility to represent. So
That brings up an interesting question about whether in your work you actually feel like you have to explain culture to people, because it's not really typical American culture. If it's Filipino American culture or Philippine culture, you ever feel like there's a pressure on you either from Filipinos or from Americans or editors or critics to explain these things? I mean, for example, you actually, when you were, I think you were reading and you actually used the word kampung, and you actually felt like you had to translate
yes,
it.
I did.
Even though in the book, it's not translated.
It's not translated, yeah.
And so do you ever feel, any of you feel, that you've got to explain culture almost like a translation when you're writing, and does it appear in your writing, do you think? Jeremy, why don't you start?
I think that is a common Singaporean anxiety. Mm. This book was published in Singapore, and I had to fight my editor who wanted to explain everything. And I was like, this is going to be largely distributed in Singapore, so who exactly are you explaining it to? And B, so what if it is opaque? You know, as long as it doesn't completely obscure meaning, I think it's good to have a little unknowability rather than to play into this myth that many people have, that the world should be entirely explicable. So no, I am all for the unknown, because encountering it is the only way you might possibly learn something.
Jessica, we're going to have to cut it off after this, but Jessica, you go back to a time when Filipinos, I mean, you're really the first person to make a mark among Filipino writers in the United States.
Oh,
God,
pioneer.
Jessica, you are so old. Oh, my God.
No, I know what you're
Did
saying.
They have writing when you, you know, they, you know.
Cave paintings. Okay, what's the question again?
The question is, did you feel like in your work that you and your editor felt like there were certain things you had to explain for a culture that wasn't
We had those conversations, and I said, I'm not explaining. To quote Jeremy, who hasn't been born yet, I feel part of the fun of writing is, and I'm not here to get so obscure that nobody gets, you want people to get it, but I feel like they will get it. I don't underestimate people's intelligence. I feel like if they're going to reach for my book, they want to go there. Mm-hmm. And if they don't get everything, that's fine. But part of my challenge is to contextualize it somehow, but I don't want to make it work. I don't want to be so self-conscious about every moment and feel like, is this accessible or not? I just want to sort of, yeah, I'll just say he put it beautifully, and I think that's where writers should go and trust themselves and trust the reader. Mm-hmm.
Gina, you have actually history in your book. Did you feel like you know that you needed to do background information for people so they would understand what you were talking about?
No, not really. No, and my editor also didn't. She was very happy. She actually went after some Filipino who actually said, oh, there's too much Filipino history here, no one's going to buy it. And he's Filipino, and my editor went after him to say, you know, I read this, and I even though I didn't get everything, I wanted this to be out in the world. But there are some books that are more closed than others. And so if I'm writing a book where I think I want to be really generous with the reader, I imagine I would be doing something differently. I would be writing about history differently, and I would be explaining because I want this open window, an open door to the reader. Mm-hmm. But but there are some stories that are also a lot more closed, and they want that. They want that hermetic thinking about that thing, about history, that maybe others won't share. I mean, I've read Proust, and I didn't know everything about the Dreyfus Affair, and no one, you know, it's like, I didn't go around being sad that I didn't know everything about about everything in the life of Paris in 1920, you know, so, and I approach literature like that, and so why would my writing have a different demand from the reader, demand of difficulty?
Let's leave it at that. I'm going to open it up to a couple of questions from the audience, and I'll repeat your question. So if you have a question of any of our four authors, go ahead.
We
have a microphone here. You're going to...
Thank you all for the beautiful readings and this wonderfully rich conversation. I noticed in the four selections of readings from each of you tonight that there was an interesting parallelism, right? That all of you spoke in some way about either personal intimate crisis or personal intimate crises that were tied in some way to larger social or national or cultural crises, right? So I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about how you think of yourselves and other writers and your roles in our culture at a particular moment of crises, right? When we're boundaries are being policed in new and more vigorous and painful ways, when we're in the midst of a refugee crisis, we're in the midst of increasing difficulties for immigrants and those on the margins in sort of a so-called globalized world. So where do you think of writers, either as speaking for yourselves or for writers more broadly, in this particular moment, writing through and about crises at this time? Thank you.
Wow. Who are you?
I'm Malaysian.
I love your question. It's so, it's like an octopus. I think writers are more important than ever, but I don't know if in this culture that matters. The world is so crazy, but I'm of the belief that everything personal is political. It's a cliche, but for me it's true, and that, you know, every choice we make, the smallest thing, you know, and I don't mean we sit around thinking about who made this piece of bread or whatever. I'm talking, even I know you do. but what worries me is, in particular, this country and how little writers really matter here anyway. But the kind of writing I love and have always aspired to is the kind of writing that grapples with the big and the small kind of... I mean, my favorite novel is 2666. I don't know if you've ever read it, but I think Bolaño could foresee what's going on now. But he was also using the past, and he was using the crises that was going on right around him. Mm-hmm. But it resonates with me with everything that's going on now. I mean, so I think in a way great literature, you know, can see into the future as it tackles the past and the crises, as you say, that's going on with that writer in that particular moment, 1955 or 1978 or whatever. I mean, I don't know if that's answering your question.
I mean, I'm always thinking about the future, and in, because of the of our present, that's why I write about 1896.
Not 1898.
1898, actually. Right now, it's I'm in 1908.
1903.
I'm in 1908. I graduated.
I think you should feel a need to explain the history around that.
Oh, yeah. I'm really obsessed at the moment with the Filipino-American War, and I think it's because of the moment that we are right now. The very close, I mean, even Donald Trump mentioned in a weird psychedelic moment, the bullets put in pig's blood that was used to shoot the Muslims with John Pershing. John Pershing, the John Pershing moment he's talking about is the military governor of Mindanao in the Muslim South in the Philippines, who became the World War I Expeditionary Force general and brought his men from the Filipino-American War to create the military intelligence protocols of the U.S. Army, the very first ones, moving on into the McCarthy era, moving on into the NSA. The connections between the history of the colonized to current events is just immense. And that's why I keep writing about the past.
But it never ends. I mean, it never changes, does it?
The past never ends.
No, I mean, and the colonizing. No, it's empire after empire. I mean, you know, this isn't something new, right?
Yeah. Another question?
Everybody.
Yeah, go ahead. Oh, wait for the microphone.
Okay. Hi, thank you for this panel. And this question is to all four of you, and I guess, you know, respectively to the Filipino culture and to Singaporean. How much are Filipino works, you know, sort of promoted, say, in the education system, and as are Singaporean works in the education system? Like, you know, is it something that a person has to go out of his own way to discover Filipino work or Singaporean work, or is it something that is sort of like spread around in culture and is just known?
And that's an interesting question, don't you think, too? Because is it American work, or is it Filipino work, or is it... I don't know. I think it's simpler for you to answer.
Well, if you go into a public library in Singapore, there is a section called fiction and a section called nonfiction, and then a sort of little ghetto called Singaporean, which comprises all. And you kind of have to often go out of your way to find it. It's not the first thing you see when you go into the library.
What's interesting about that is that it's not fiction or nonfiction. It's somewhere in between.
Yes. It's unclassifiable.
Yes.
In schools, though, I think since 10 years ago, maybe the Ministry of Education in Singapore has been trying to push for more Singaporean writing to be incorporated into the syllabus. Of course, they're still very conservative. They got a lot of rules as to, you know, no gay people in those books. No.
Oh, really?
Well. Yeah. Yeah. Singapore.
Oh, that's right, you don't have bubble gum either.
Yeah.
Well, gay people, bubble gum. It's the same.
Yeah. I can't blow stuff in Singapore.
Yeah.
I want to try to tackle your question.
So I guess, you know, Filipino works, not, maybe not for the both of you, but Filipino writers in general, are their works, you know, sort of promoted by the education system?
The educational system, you mean like...
when schools and...
The Ministry of Education.
Well, they hardly even teach literature in schools in America. No, I'm really... Yeah, it's terrible.
But what about in the Philippines, for example? I mean, do they push literature? We all know
in
that
the universities they do.
Well, they have a new K-12 yeah. program that they're trying to set up, and I know just from what I understand, I was just told by one of my classmates from elementary school that he's teaching this book. He's now a high school teacher, and he's teaching this book, and it includes my work. So it's very nice, you know. So there, it's been codified in some textbooks. Mm-hmm. At the same time that if you're going to a bookstore and you want to buy some Filipino books, it's very hard to find the Filipino books. Mm-hmm. But there are textbooks where the stories are.
It's still always looking to the, you know, outside world for affirmation. I suppose the fancy bookstores will have a little shelf of Philippine writers in the Philippines. I'm talking about that, published by one the Philippine publishers, and it'll be a little. But everything else will be what you could find here in a bookstore, you know. But I'm concerned about where I live, which is right here, and how our work is perceived, which I think you're also asking about, yes? Because, you know, I was murmuring to Gina, are we seen as American writers? Are we seen as Filipino-American writers? But are we seen as Philippine writers who are sort of expats, have been here forever? I mean, there's all these little niche things that make me uncomfortable. And, you know, they will trot us out for the festivals. Right. It's kind of, you know, no, the Penn Festival, they'll need some, one of this and one of that and one of this, or the something festival, you know. But are you part of the conversation of just regular old America? I mean, we do live here. I pay taxes. I've lived here forever, you know. So I don't know. It's an interesting question. I know we're taught in universities here, in Philippine studies or in contemporary lit, in universities. Mm. Certain universities will teach our work. Mm. So, you know.
Well, you also. I mean, it's interesting because a lot of your work really doesn't have anything to do with Filipinos or the Philippines. Mm. I mean, some of the last couple of novels are almost, especially the last one, really didn't have that much to do with Filipinos.
I know.
So.